सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरि ओम. We were looking at the commentary of Shankaracharya on the fourth sutra, Tattu Samanvayat. And there we are seeing how the previous sutra has got a meaning or relevance, that is Shastra Yonitvat. Here, the opponent's view that scriptures cannot be the source of the means of knowledge of Brahman, and also that Brahman cannot be the source of scriptures, is refuted. First, it is told, Nacha tat gatanam padanam Brahma swarupa vishaye nischite samanvaye avagamyamane arthantara kalpana yukta shruta hani ashruta kalpana prasangat. So there, those particular, in the previous passage, some Upanishadic statements were quoted, which clearly show that the goal of these statements is to understand Brahman or to realize Brahman. Now, when that is directly told and it is told without any doubt, then to say that the goal of these Vedantic statements is to actually support ritualistic passages of the Vedas will be unnecessarily positing a different meaning, artha antara kalpana, imagining a different meaning which is not logical here, and also it will be telling something which is not told, and also not listening to or not supporting what has been clearly told. Shrutahani means what has been told is not accepted, and ashruta kalpana, what is not told is imagined. So that cannot happen. Now further, Shankaracharya says, Nacha tesham kartra devatadi swarupa parata avasiyate tat kena kam paschet. This is from Brihadanyaka Upanishad. Ityadi kriya karaka phala nirakarana shrutehe. So if you remember, the opponent's view was that, you see, these Vedantic texts are basically texts which are dependent on the ritualistic texts, and they try to explain the nature of the agent or karta, kartra, and the deity involved, and also other things associated with the ritual. That was one of, so that way we can say that Vedantic texts are purposeful. The purpose of those Vedantic texts are not to talk about Brahman, but to talk about the deity and also the agent, etc., of the ritual. That was one viewpoint of the opponent. So there, here it is told, that is also not acceptable. Why? Tesham, there means those statements which were quoted earlier. Kartra devatadi swarupa parata. Parata means their purport or their meaning, to be teaching the swarupa, nature of kartra, agent, devata, deity, adi, and so on, means other things, connected things. Avasiyate may be determined, that earlier we have said na cha means no. So it may not be determined like that. Tat, then, because that Upanishad is quoted. Tat kena kam pashyat, pashyet. Tat means then, kena, by what means, kam, whom, pashyet, could one see. So, if these Vedantic statements were talking about the agent, then you cannot have a statement like tat kena kam pashyet, means then, by what means, whom could one see. Because if you are talking about these statements explaining the nature of the agent, then such a statement does not make any sense, because that statement should explain the nature of agent, whereas that statement itself is asking who sees what, or by what means whom could be seen, could what see. So what is seen and by what means itself is asked by the Upanishad. So how can you say that this Upanishad is supporting rituals by telling about the Devata and also the agent? Because the question is whom is seen and by what means it is seen. So ityadi kriya karaka phala nirakarana shuddhe. So here nirakarana, that is denied. What is denied? Shrute in the scriptural passages or scriptural texts. Kriya means action. Karaka, causal condition, means karaka means any condition which is necessary for an action. And phala and fruits of the action. All these things are denied. Nirakarana. They are denied or quashed or set aside by such statements. Tat kena kam pashyet. So that is why you cannot say that their purpose is to tell about the agent and also about the deity and other connected things. Connected with what? With the rituals. That cannot be told. Further he says, Nacha parinishtita vastu swarupatve api pratyaksha adi vishayatvam brahmanah. Tattvamasi, Chandogya Upanishad, iti Brahma Atma Bhavasya Shastram Antarena Anavagamya Manatvat. So here again he says, nor again, nacha means again, further. Parinishtita Vastu Swarupatve Api. Though, api here means though it is by nature an entity. Vastu means an entity. That is parinishtita, means that is already in existence, that is established in existence. Its existence is established. Though such an entity, we are talking about the nature of an entity of whose existence is established, even then, pratyakshadi vishayatvam, because it is the object of or the subject of perception and so on, means six means of knowledge are there. So pratyaksha, anumana, etc. So this is the subject of all these kind of means of knowledge. What is the object of the means of knowledge? This Brahman. Brahman, though it is established, it is already in existence, and though it is the object of perception, inference, etc., tattvamasi iti. In Chandogya Upanishad, it is told that tattvamasi, that you are that. Brahmatma bhavasya, that means Brahma and Brahman is Atman. Brahman and Atman are identical. So the nature of Brahman is actually Atman. Shastram antarena avagamya anavagamya manatvat. So you see, whatever we see are in essence, it is Brahman. And it is existing, it is established. It's an established entity. So when you see a jug, you see a jug on your table and you know that it is a jug. And it is an established thing. And so because you see it, you don't need any other means of knowledge to prove that the jug exists in front of you on the table. But though you see Brahman, means in essence Brahman is seen as names and forms, etc. But to know that it is the same Atman and Brahman as it is told in the Upanishads from statements like Tattvamasi, you cannot know it by ordinary means. So though it is an entity which is established, though it is something which is quite established, and also though it is indirectly perceived through sense organs and also through six means of knowledge, but Brahma Atma Bhava, that Atman is Brahman or Brahman is Atman, there is no difference. This identity of Jivatma and Brahman cannot be understood Shastra Mantarena. Other than Shastras, nothing Anavagamya Manatvat. It cannot be understood or it cannot be ascertained Anavagamya. It cannot be ascertained other than through the scriptures. That is the point. So, you see, these statements are not talking about rituals. They are talking about the identity of Brahman and Atman. Why? Because apart from the scriptures, you cannot get any other evidence for the fact that Brahman is identical to Atman or Atman is Brahman. Only in scripture we get such statements, Tattvamasi, like that. Then again, he says, Yattu heya upadeya rahitatvat upadesha anarthakyamiti na esha dosha hai, heya upadeya shunya brahma atmata avagamat eva sarva klesha praharanat purushartha siddhehe. Says, Yattu, as regarding heya upadeya rahitatvat, means which is devoid or which is free from. Heya means that which has to be rejected. Upadeya means that which has to be accepted. So that which is free from, that which has to be rejected and that which has to be accepted. Upadesha anarthakyam, the futility of the teaching. Iti thus, na, not at all. Eshaha, this doshaha, defect. Heya upadeya shunya Brahma Atmata Avagamat Eva. Because Avagamat, realization of Avagamat means from the realization Eva. Only by the realization of Brahman, Atmata means Brahma as Atman. So by the realization that Brahman and Atman are identical, Heya Upadeya Shunya. And what is Brahman and Atman, or Brahman and Atman are identical, but what is Brahman? Which is something which you cannot reject or accept, because it is there. It is the only thing which is there. Nothing else is there. So it cannot be rejected or accepted. So sarva klesha prahanat, and also because of the total prahana means destruction or stopping of sarva klesha, all kinds of suffering. Purushartha siddhehe, and that why? Because that is the siddhehe, that is the success of purushartha, human goal. So here, what does that mean? It means upadesha anarthakyam. Now you see, Mimamsakas are telling that Vedanta statements or Vedantic texts found in the Vedas are Veda usharaha. Vedosharaha means they are like deserts in Vedas. Why? Because they lack any purpose. They are futile. They are purposeless. That is what is told by the Mimamsakas. Why? Because they don't point directly to any rituals. So that they are supportive of rituals, they have given these ideas that yes, they talk about the deity or the they talk about the agent, etc. Or they tell that they are auxiliary texts to the texts which talk about prohibitions and injunction. Or they say that they, in general, make a person do those rituals. So they are purposeful. But here, Shankaracharya is denying all those things. Now, when we deny all these things, then this objection that Vedantic texts are purposeless, futile, it is remaining. Now when you are denying that they are not talking about deity, etc. or other things connected to rituals, then this objection remains, that then they are useless. So for that, Shankaracharya is saying, you see, they are not useless. Why they are not useless? Because Brahman is beyond that which can be rejected or accepted. So all the ritualistic portions talk about either injunction or prohibition. Means vidhi. Vidhi means injunction, to do some action. And prohibition means nisheda, which says don't do this. So that means you have to accept something and you have to reject something. But Brahman can not be accepted. So heya is rejection. Upadeya is that which has to be accepted. So Brahman cannot be either accepted or rejected. It is devoid of that. rahitatvat, it is divine on that, it is free from that. And so that is why we have to say, what we have to say, we have to say that this is not a defect. You see, in Mimamsa, every statement should either accept something or tell you to do something, or it should prohibit you from doing something. Only then it is acceptable. But we say that that is not a defect. So according to Mimamsa, if a text does not do that, it is a defect of the text. But Vedantin says that no, it is not a defect of the text. Na esha doshah. It is not a dosha. It is not a defect at all. Why it is not a defect? Because only when you know that Brahman is Atman and the nature of Brahman is that which you cannot accept or reject, only then purushartha siddhihi. Only then purushartha siddhihi. Then you successfully attain the goal of human life. So Sri Ramakrishna says, God realization is the goal of human life. Where did he get this from? You can quote Brahma Sutra, Shankaracharya is also saying. But of course it is there in other texts also. It is the purushartha siddhehe. So it is the fulfillment of human goal. What is the fulfillment of human goal? Sarva klesha prahana. The fulfillment of human goal is Brahmatma ta avagama. To understand that Brahman and Atman is one. That is the fulfillment of human goal. And how does it come? Along with that, what does come? It comes, along with it comes sarva klesha prahana. Comes the destruction of all suffering. So, popularly we call it atyantika dukkha nivritti. Atyantika dukkha nivritti. That means atyantika means completely, complete. Dukkha. Dukkha means suffering. Nivritti means removal. So removal of, complete removal of suffering. So this is what happens when you know that Atman and Brahman are same. And this cannot be accepted or ejected. So the fact that you are saying either it should be vidhi or nisheda, we don't accept that. Because Brahman can neither be accepted nor rejected. So it is not futile. This text is not futile. So upadesha anarthakya, anartha. Anartha means futility. So it is not futile. It is not useless. Then he says, devata pratipadanasya tu svavakya gata upasana paratve api na kashchit virodaha. Na tu tatha brahmana upasana vidisheshatvam sambhavati. Ekatve heya upadeya shunyataya kriya karakadi dvaita vijnana upa mardopapattehe nahi brahmaikatva vijnanena unmathitasya dvaita vijnanasya punah sambhava asti yena upasana vidisheshatvam brahmana pratipadyeta. So you see, other thing which was told about was the, in the objection by the Mimamsakas, they said that you see these Vedantic texts, they talk about so many meditations and contemplations. So through that also they are talking about these ritualistic portion, and so that we can accept that to be a purpose of these statements. So that is also now being set aside or quashed. He is saying, devatadi pratipadanasya tu. That means regarding the scriptural passages, explaining, pratipadana means explaining, devatadi, about the deity and other aspects related to the ritual. Sva vakya gata upasana paratve api. Sva vakya gata means that which is evident in the text itself. Swavakya means in their own text. So, upasana paratvyapi, even though they talk about contemplation, which is quite clear in the text itself, na, no, kashchit, any virodha, opposition. There is no opposition. So, even if the scriptural texts are talking about some contemplation in the text itself, even then there is no opposition. Why? There is no opposition. Why? Na tu tatha, na means not, tu but tatha. Similarly, Brahmanah of Brahman, upasana vidisheshatvam sambhavati. So it is not possible that Brahman can be subsidiary to vidhi, some injunction, which is connected to contemplation. So Brahman cannot be subsidiary to injunction on contemplation. There cannot be Brahman, you cannot say that vidhi seshatva means it is subsidiary to a particular injunction. You cannot say. So all these contemplations are all right. We don't have any opposition there. But you cannot say that Brahman is subsidiary to injunction of contemplation. Why? Because ekatve, when one realizes ekatve sati, that we have to add, means once we realize is not given, the oneness. Once we realize oneness, once the person realizes the oneness of Atman and Brahman, Heya Upadeya Shunyata, then Shunyataya, because there is nothing which has to be rejected or accepted. Kriya Karakadi Dvaita Vijnana Upamarda Upapattehe. So then what happens? There is Upamarda, there is destruction of Kriya. There is the destruction of Dvaita Vijnana. There is the destruction of the idea of, Vijnana means idea of Dvaita, duality. Okay, what kind of duality? Kriya, action. Karaka, causal condition. Adi. So, cause, the causal circumstances for a particular action to take place, the agent, the instrument, so many things are involved in an action, and the action, all these dualistic notions go away the moment you realize that Atman is Brahman. The moment somebody realizes Aham Brahmasmi, all these dualistic notions go away. When dualistic notions go away, then there is no question of something to be accepted or rejected. Why? Because who will accept and who will reject? What will be accepted and what will be rejected? Only Brahman is. So that particular duality goes away. And so you cannot say that Brahman is subsidiary to the vidhi of upasana, that a particular contemplation has to be done. Suppose the contemplation has to be done on some particular devata. Then you can say that the contemplation on that particular devata is subsidiary to the vidhi. Because that vidhi says we have to do contemplation or meditation, upasana on that devata. But contemplation on Brahman cannot be like that. Because Brahman is beyond all dualistic notions. So though there is contemplation on Brahman talked about, though there is contemplation talked about in the Upanishads, or in the Vedantic text, we have no problem with that being representative of the fact that Atman is identical to Brahman. Just because these contemplation or upasana or meditations are talked about in Vedantic texts, do not mean that, just because they are taught, does not mean that they lead to some ritualistic action. Why? Because they, when you do this contemplation and gradually when suddenly you understand the oneness, that means the non-duality of Brahman, ekameva advitiyam. So when you understand that, then there is nothing which can be accepted or rejected. Then there is no dualistic notion of action, the person who is doing, and the causal conditions, kriya, karaka, etc. Nahi brahmaikatva vijnanena unmathitasya dvaita vijnanasya puna sambhavah asti. And also this is very important. Also, once brahmaikatva vijnanena, brahma ekatva, Vijnana, the knowledge of the oneness of Brahman. That means only Brahman is. The knowledge of the non-duality of Brahman. Unmatitasya, Dvaita Vijnanasya. So by the realization of oneness of Brahman, Brahma Ekatva Vijnanena, what happens? Unmatita, eradicated. What is eradicated? Dvaita Vijnana, the notion of duality. So all notion of duality is eradicated by the knowledge of oneness of Brahman. Then Dvaita Vijnanasya Puna Sambhavam Na Asti, the notion of duality cannot come again. Puna Sambhavam, resurgence cannot come, relapse cannot be there. There can be no relapse. If you realize Brahman, that is it. Then you have realized it. You cannot be like, oh, I studied, now it is so long, now I have forgotten. Calculus, I had studied so long, now I don't do. I only do copy-paste because I am working in IT industry. Basically, IT industry in India does that. Copy-paste, no? Maximum people are doing that. Copy-paste. And designation will be very great. Like some analyst, this, that. But all people are doing is copy-paste. So now, I forgot calculus. Padha tha, thoda thoda yaad hai. Engineering mein padha tha, abhi bhul gaya. It cannot happen like that. Brahman, once you have realized, that's all. All notions of duality go away. So people is not taking to nicely. Copy-paste karte hai, kya hum sara thi? Ego mein lag raha hai. Taste points the ego ko. Upasana vidhi sheshatvam brahmanah pratipadyeta. Yena. So if duality, notions of duality were to come again, then we could have told that upasana vidhi sheshatvam, that Brahman is subsidiary to the injunction on contemplation. But because that is not going to happen, the moment a person realizes oneness of Brahman, non-dual idea only will be there and dualistic notions will not come again. So this thing, that injunction of contemplation is subsidiary. Brahman is subsidiary to injunction of contemplation, cannot be accepted. So this is how Shankaracharya point by point refutes the idea that Vedantic statements found in the Upanishads, etc., or in the Vedas in general, are futile. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat.